My year of living prayerfully actually started in the red light district of Amsterdam. My wife and I were shooting a documentary about human trafficking, and the din was crazy. Hundreds of drunk guys chanting outside a bar, women in the windows, totally overwhelming. As I stood in the middle of this, I thought, God, you need to end this. I thought, God, I need your power in prayer. So I traveled 37,000 miles around the world to explore various prayer traditions. It was a crazy year. I documented my journey for all my friends and family who couldn't take a year to do it for themselves. Prayer can literally change the course of history. It changed me, and I know it can change you.
Well, Jared's here to talk more about prayer, and well, what did you learn at the end of the 12 months? What did you learn?
Oh, man. Biggest thing is that prayer is a relationship. Mm-hmm. I like to say that, you know, if you have dinner every day with Bill Gates, you're going to get better at spending your money, and if you spend time with Jesus in prayer, you're going to become more like him.
So it's more relational than anything else.
Yeah, prayer for me used to be God was Santa Claus, and it was me asking for
Christmas.
Things. Yeah.
Asking for presents.
Yeah, exactly.
Instead of asking for him. Did you find that you were able to get answers?
Yeah, but not in the way you would have thought. It's like, God, give me a car, and I got a car. It wasn't like that. The big prayer that I pray is Shalom. I went to Jerusalem and Bethlehem, and it's such a, you know, place at war, and Shalom is this great sense of peace. And so I pray Shalom a lot as I watch the news or if I'm feeling stressed, and there's something about that that just connects you with God.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's one of the commandments in the Psalms,
yeah,
to
exactly.
Pray for the peace of the Shalom of Jerusalem. Mm-hmm. And unless we pray that, it's never going to come. And I'm of the belief until the Prince of Peace comes, it's never going to come.
Totally. If we don't have peace within, we're never going to have world peace.
Let's get into one of the specifics here where you went to Mount Athos, which maybe viewers don't know is the sort of the spiritual
yes.
place in the Eastern Orthodox tradition. Mm-hmm. And it's a repository of learning, but it's also a place where a lot of monks get together and pray and pray continually
yeah.
and try to devote themselves to that.
Yeah, so they actually use, I'm wearing the metonymy right now, and they put their thumb on the knot, and as they breathe in and breathe out, they pray, Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And the idea is that every breath will become a prayer, and they'll begin to pray without ceasing. So I love finding ways to attach physicality to spirituality. So as I shower, God cleanse me from all unrighteousness. As I put on my clothes, put on the armor of God. Figuring out ways to attach the physical and the spiritual so that prayer is happening all the time.
You changed the Jesus prayer.
You
didn't want to have mercy on me, a sinner. You didn't want to take that, the prayer that actually Jesus recommended.
Yes.
You said, have mercy on me, your son.
Yeah, I don't tell the monks on Athos. So I alternate. I go, Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have favor on me, a son, because I've been adopted into the family.
I've heard of even a variant of that, have mercy on your beloved.
Mm.
That you we all need to recognize sin has been done away with
yes.
on the cross,
yes.
and we're all beloved in him. One of the monks said to you that in your search that the prayer isn't taken. These secrets aren't taken. They're given.
Mm.
What did that do for you?
I think it reminded me of my marriage. The Bible is obviously full of spiritual metaphors that are relational. And I look at my marriage, like I couldn't force my wife to love me. I can't force her to talk to me or share anything with me. That only happens when I'm giving, when I'm sharing, when I'm loving and talking and communicating. And I think that's what it is with our spiritual life too, is anything that we receive from God is a total gift.
Everything.
Everything. Yeah.
Everything.
Yeah.
Even the breath that you take mm-hmm. in and the one that you're able to push out
totally.
Is a gift.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, for me, that's been one of the great insights. Everything mm-hmm. is a gift. The mere fact that we're able to talk is a miracle.
Mm-hmm. It changes the way you view the world and your place in it.
Where do you go from here?
Well, 37,000 miles around the world, went to North Korea, met the Pope, it's been a crazy year. I'm going to spend the next year sharing this story, trying to convince people to pray. We actually started a second nonprofit that owns the book, so all the money goes to charity, and we just want people to have a revival of their prayer life, and then we want to help people in need.
You ever tempted to go into a monastery and just do this full time?
I don't think my wife would put up with that.
So no temptation there?
No, certainly not.
To live a life devoted to it?
I think you can do it anywhere. I don't think you have to be in a monastery to pray without ceasing. I think it can happen to any person watching this show. It happened to us.
You went to Brother Lawrence's house.
I did.
And he wrote a wonderful book, mm-hmm. Practicing the Presence of Jesus, mm-hmm. of Christ. And how was that lesson for you?
That was amazing. You know, like the story of Brother Lawrence, you know, washing dishes and practicing the presence of God. His kitchen kind of disappeared. So through many months of research, I refound it in Paris, France. And yeah, that was really cool for me because here's just a humble, everyday dude like me, like you, like all of us. And yet he tried to make every moment about being with God, and it changed him.
Did you ever get an answer to the question that if God knows everything, knows the future, is your prayer effective? Are you really able to change things?
Yeah, there's a quote, I think it was by Spurgeon. He said, what if our prayer is in the predestination? What if God assumed from the beginning of the world that his people would talk to him? That's a good assumption, that I'll talk to my spouse, that I'll talk to my parents. And I think maybe God assumed that his kids would talk to him.
That's a good assumption.
I think so.
That's a really good assumption. Mm-hmm. I think it's a good assumption that his kids would actually believe.
Totally.
And in that belief be transformed.
Yeah.
And then transform the reality around them.
Yes. If God is working in us, then he can work through us and around us.
And enable us to bring his peace.
Totally.
And be that messenger of peace. Mm-hmm. Is that the next step for you? Is that what you're going to do?
Well,
a messenger of peace?
Yeah, like, I mean, my wife and I run a charity to fight human trafficking, so we've made a couple documentaries on the issue, and we're going to keep fighting that, trying to convince people to pray. And the hope is that we can see a revival, that as our lives change and as people's lives change, that it will change the world.
You have taken on probably the toughest task there is to take on, and that's stopping sex trafficking.
It's modern day slavery.
You can see individual successes, but on a larger framework, the business seems to be highly resistant to reform.
Yeah.
And I find it incredible in the modern age how pervasive it is.
Yeah.
And how prevalent it is in every single continent, in every single major city.
We need to be talking about it. We got to talk about porn addiction. We've got to talk about sexuality, relationships, how we view women. Laws need to change. We need to end demand for paid sex. Because if men are paying for sex, women will be trafficked. And so, yeah, it's a huge issue we've got to tackle. And I think the church is the only thing on earth that's big enough to deal with it.
God is the only thing on earth.
Of course. The body of Christ. Yeah.
The body of Christ.
Yeah.
Him working through us to bring positive change.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, the book is called A Year of Living Prayerfully. And if you want to find out more about Jared's adventures, all you have to do is pick it up and read it. And pay attention to what he talks about and the lessons that he's learned. It's available wherever books are sold. Jared, thank you for being with us.
Thanks
for your witness.